I'm gonna try it compared to like a non-dehydrated, fully hydrated one.
Do you have your milk ready?
I'm impressed by you, Daisy. Hi, and welcome back to Chemists in the Kitchen. Today we're going to talk about food preservation, which is actually something that has been around for a long time. And we're going to talk about different fruits and the amount of water that they have in them and how we can remove that water by heating them for a long period of time.
Hi everyone, my name is Benny Eng. I'm an associate professor of chemistry at Los Angeles Pierce College. I teach introductory chemistry and general chemistry.
Hi, I'm Daisy Rosas Vargas. I am a science communicator and I am a chemist by training.
I'm Julie Pollock and I am an associate professor of chemistry at the University of Richmond. I teach organic chemistry and biochemistry as well as chemical biology.
I'm interested in why you picked chili because I don't think it's a common fruit or vegetable for the dehydration.
So I chose chili because, you know, there's a lot of chili involved in Latin American cooking. When people were first, you know, growing their fruits and vegetables, maybe they had a lot left over. Instead of letting all that go to waste, they thought, how can we preserve this? People have done pickling, salting, and of course, heat drying. And that may take several days, several months using just the sun, but it really depends on like where you are in the world. So you cannot dehydrate if you are in like the Amazon rainforest. Horrible conditions to dehydrate. You need to get rid of moisture, not have a huge environment filled with like a lot of water.
The reason why we want to preserve them is because we don't want bacteria to grow in them, because if bacteria grows in them, it will cause the food to spoil. And then the reason why bacteria can grow so well is because there's so much moisture that's there. Our bodies have like about 60% water, but fruits and vegetables have an even higher amount of water. And the way that people preserve them for the most part is to figure out ways to stop that bacteria to grow. And one of the most common ways is actually to remove the water from it. Luckily, you can do drying in a kitchen and with things that you probably already have in your kitchen, like an oven or like we're gonna do an air fryer.
I love sweet stuff. So for me, when you dehydrate it, all the sugar will actually be more concentrated. And if some of the fruits have amylase, the process of breaking down starch into simple sugar, then when you taste it, it'll be even sweeter. So I think that's an advantage of dehydration.
So I chose two different types of chili peppers. I chose serranos and a jalapeno. I'm actually gonna weigh them. So I actually wanna see how much water content gets lost. I did look up the water content for these jalapenos and it's roughly around 90%. I wanna see a color change. Maybe at the end, I do want to taste it. So I might use one of the spare ones that I have to like taste it. Do I taste something different? When I dehydrate them, they're going to become spicier because we concentrate the capsaicin.
So I am going to dehydrate apples. So I have a red gala apple and then also a green Granny Smith, which actually was grown in my backyard, which is kind of exciting, I think. Actually, what I'm really interested in the difference in the sweetness and sourness associated with them. So Granny Smith are very, very sour apples, whereas gala apples are significantly sweeter. So I'm excited to see how that translates. Apples are close to what you said for your chili peppers. They're about 85% water, so a little bit lower.
One thing I learned about is apple has some polyphenol oxidase that usually causing the fruits to turn brown.
Yep.
So if you're changing the temperature, again, it's, you know, it's a science, right? The temperature and the duration, maybe you can also look into whether or not they have the same brownness without turning brown. So I think that could be something that can look into as well.
So it's a great point. I also was interested in that because I'm gonna cut the apples because I'm not gonna dehydrate the whole apple, obviously, together. I'm gonna do slices of it. And really what I have ready is a bowl of lemon juice, well, water with lemon juice, to actually stop that browning process from happening. for the exact same reason that you're talking about. So there's the polyphenol oxidases that are in there that cause the polyphenols to get oxidized, which then react with amino acids and cause that browning.
I'm going to pick a golden kiwi because instead of a regular kiwi, because as I mentioned earlier, I want something sweet. So, and if I'm dehydrating something, I want to make sure that it's sweeter, not more sour. I assume that it should have lots of moisture for even for golden kiwis. It should be easily 85% or higher.
So should we start prepping and get them in?
Yes.
Let's do it.
Let's do it.
So I kind of want to leave an opening where water vapor can escape.
So I think first I'm going to peel off the skin and then I'm going to just put them in slices. So it'll be like a chips.
That's what I'm doing. I just sliced mine with my mandolin and then I'm just coring them, throwing mine into my lemon water. I am also adding some cinnamon to my apples.
I think mine's gonna take a while. So I am gonna do 130 degrees Fahrenheit. I'm gonna do 4 hours.
So I'm doing 135 degrees Fahrenheit. I'm gonna check it after about 10 minutes first, and then I'll check it, you know, at the half hour mark, as well as 2 hours and 4 hours.
So I'm gonna do 140 degree Fahrenheit. I'm gonna try to set it up for 2 hours.
For my apple slices that I have a lot of surface area. They're very thinly cut them. I put them at like an eighth of an inch so that as it's going around, the water can come out from everywhere. But you have a lot more skin around the outside of yours. It doesn't surprise me that it would be slower. All right, so should we collect some data and see what they look like now that we've got some time gone by?
A fully hydrated jalapeno versus not. You can't really tell, but this one's like a tad more yellow. So this one's the one that's been slightly dehydrated for 30 minutes. It is squishier. Like it's not okay. It's not as rigid. When I did this one for like 60 minutes, I lost about 18% of my water.
For the two edges, the one with the thinnest slice, the water loss was actually the greatest, not a surprise because it's the thinnest. So on average, it's about 34% after 30 minutes.
I'm interested a little bit, Daisy, you said the texture. Do you have the texture of your one from that you did earlier that was like the longer time point?
Oh my gosh! Yeah, that's so much more yellow.
Very yellow.
It looks wrinkly.
It's wrinkly.
And squishy.
So I was doing a little bit of research, and if you have high amounts of fiber, you're able to contain a bit more water. So compared to your apple versus kiwi, there's a lot more fiber in apple, which is why you can maintain maybe a little bit of tiny chewiness, again, depending on how thin you cut it, mm-hmm. compared to Benny's kiwi, which might be like, oh, maybe like a chip, but definitely like you're gonna have that giant texture chain. Biggest difference might honestly be my Serrano. It like has shrunk.
Oh my gosh, yeah. Oh. Is it getting some brown to it at all?
Yes, like it's getting to the correct size. This was a lot larger. This is the store-bought one.
Clearly raw apple, if I bend it, it breaks really quite easily. So my 30 minute apple, very, much like a wet piece of paper, but the flavor is pretty well retained. A little bit more tart than the zero time point one. My 2 hour one is, you can see it's not like flapping at all. It's really quite solid. And so if I go to bend it, it doesn't snap like the raw one does, but it definitely bends and it can be like torn very easily. This one's chewy. I do think it's more tart the longer that it is. Like, I don't know if something's happening to the sugar that it's breaking down a little bit. My 4 hour one, it's breaking maybe a little bit more, but it's still not like solidly breaking. Like I have to kind of rip it to break it. Texture is a little less chewy than 2 hours, but not much. And the amount of the water seems to be about the same amount of water that was, yeah, in terms of the percentage of the mass seemed about the same.
This one's 2 hours. I'm gonna try it compared to like a non-dehydrated, fully hydrated one.
Do you have the milk ready?
I'm impressed by you, Daisy.
I'm avoiding the placenta, which is where all the capsaicin is, so we're good. This just tastes like a green pepper. this one is the one that's actually
impressed by.
This one's sweet, like subtly sweet.
Yeah. Wow, cool.
It tastes like a red pepper, actually. Here's a 2-hour Serrano. Yeah, this one's a 30-minute one. So, difference. This one's spicy still at 30 minutes. This one is spicier after spicier? 2 hours.
Huh, interesting.
And those are supposed to be more fruity, more citrusy, and more heat compared to your like standard hydrated Serrano pepper.
This one is like the smallest one, the thinner one. It started with like 8 grams. Now it's only 3 grams.
Wow, so over half.
More than 50%, yeah.
So they look very floppy still.
Yeah, they
so
do
I bet
floppy.
Like more time, they'll become leathery, yeah.
I think the flavor is more concentrated. Mm. It's still soft, but I think it will turn more leathery, more chewy if I dehydrate for a longer period of time.
Is it worth it? That's the question. Daisy, is it worth it for chilies, do you think?
No, I think it's probably cheaper to buy 100 dried chilies in a little packet than drying 100 chilies in my air fryer. Benny, is it worth it?
Well, I think from a science point of view, it's totally worth it. You know, if you have the time, if you like something more sweeter, by dehydrating the fruit, you're removing the water, making all the sugar more concentrated. And if your fruits also have amylase, then the amylase still doing the process of breaking down the starch into simple sugar, then that make it even more sweeter. So I think from that perspective, because I like something sweet, I think I was still doing it at home. So, and then what about you, Julie?
Is it worth it?
So I would say with the apple, I'm a yes and no. I like it, it tastes good, but am I going to spend, you know, 2 to 4 hours dehydrating one apple at a time? Probably not. But I can understand why people who have more time, have that availability to be able to do it, would do it, because I think the cost of buying dehydrated fruits, and if you had a lot of them, you know, avail a lot of the fresh fruit and you wanted to extend its time.
I hope you enjoyed today's episode where we dehydrated a lot of different fruits. We saw that we removed a lot of the moisture, and hopefully this inspires you to dehydrate your own fruits or vegetables and see what else you can do with them. Maybe you want to make some fruit dust. Maybe you want to make some concentrated puree or concentrated juice.
So we hope that you are able to get into your kitchen and explore dehydrating and preserving your food. And join us next time on Chemists in the Kitchen.